Okay, so today the topic we are going to start is idea generation and project screening. So, you know, class, whenever we start a project, there is a whole set of, screening which we have to see that whether the project we are going to start is feasible or not, right? So, today we will be discussing what all would be required to accept an idea and convert it into final project, right? So, yeah. Before making investment in a project, the entrepreneur must undertake a detailed study to ensure that the project is viable. You know, because you are putting in so much money into a project, so you have to be sure that the idea is perfect and risk is less and return would be more. Yeah. So such a study is also known as feasibility study. Feasibility study is the initial design stage of a project, which brings together the elements of knowledge that indicate if a project is possible or not. So here, you know, we understand that whether this project is going to be a feasible project or not, a worthwhile project or not, right? So there are certain steps which we will be following in a feasibility study that we'll discuss in this class later on. So a feasibility study includes an estimate of the level of expertise required for a project. So first thing a feasibility study will do is understanding what kind of expertise are required and who is going to provide it, and what are the quantitative and qualitative assessments to be done, and we need to identify what are the critical factors related to the project, and scheduling everything, generating a cost estimate. So everything has to be done, right? So that all we have discussed earlier also in previous classes, and today we will understand project planning in a completely different way, where we will be understanding what all aspects has to be understood. So whether a project is viable or not, whether it can generate an equal or higher rate of return during its lifetime requires a thorough investigation of the investment per se, as well as the level of current expenditure. So basically a project feasibility study will tell you how much input you are going to put in and what would be the return. The preliminary design is the simple description of the conceived idea with an indication of the main factors to be considered in the study. So here we will be understanding that what are going to be the main factors which we must consider. Although, projects are something which will vary according to the nature of project, according to the time, according to the people involved, but there will be certain key areas which would remain same in each and every kind of project. Right, so those key areas we will be discussing today. So let's discuss the very first thing. What are the sources of idea generation? From where we get to know that something can be done to this problem, we can work upon it and generate an idea. So the very first set of people who will tell you that something can be improved as the customers. Because why we are making, why we are doing a project or why we are making a product, it is ultimately for customers. So the customer feedbacks is always very, very important, because they will tell you whether, you are doing up to the mark or not. For example, currently also you are dealing in certain kind of product. If you will not take feedback from the customers, you will not know that how to improve it and how your customers would be, completely satisfied with the product you are offering. And then one thing which is very important here, if you will not see what your customer wants, or is he happy or not with the product, then obviously after a certain time, your competitor will take over your market. So it is very important to generate brand loyalty, customer loyalty, and customer would only be loyal to you if you have really taken care of your customers. So the very first source of idea generation is your customers. Take feedback from them, understand their queries, understand their problems, and whatever their problem is, try to solve them as soon as possible, and try to incorporate those things, try to evolve your product. So this is how you can even improve your existing product or generate a new product as well. देन सेकेंड टाइप ऑफ यू नो सेकेंड सोर्स ऑफ आइडिया जनरेशन इज डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन चैनल मेंबर्स. सो डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन पर्सोनल्स हु आर इन टच विद द कस्टमर्स ऑफन गिव एक्सेलेंट सजेशन फॉर न्यू प्रोडक्ट डेवलपमेंट बिकॉज यू नो एज अ प्रोड्यूसर यू मे नॉट बी इन डायरेक्ट कॉन्टैक्ट विद द कस्टमर्स राइट. सो you need to be in touch with the people who are providing, who are in direct contact with the customer. So distribution channel members, or you can also say the retailers basically, who are in direct contact with the customer, because they have to listen what customer is feeling. So even if you are not in direct contact with the customer, then be in touch with the retailers or distribution channel members, because they will tell you is your customer happy with the product or not. So you can also, you know, here you can also, you know, have regular meetings with your retailers, with your distribution channel members, that this is how I want my product to grow, right? So distribution channel members is another source of idea generation. Then the third one is competitors. So here competitors are basically your another source of information. You know, at times it happens that the customers and distribution channels, they all are very happy with your product and service. But a competitor, he will always bring something new. It is not always necessary that you find an idea only if there is a problem in the market. You may also find an idea, you may also create, you know, demand of a certain product. You know, for example, there can be certain luxury products which were earlier not in demand. Nobody even thought of, you know, introducing any luxury product in the market. But because of, you know, heavy demand, because of heavy marketing, you can create demand of such products. So your competitors are the one who will create demand for the products even if there is no need of it. Right, so you always need to see the action plan of competitors so that you know you can cope up with it. So here it is very important to see the move of your competitor. If they are introducing a new technology, if they are improving the existing technology, you can also imbibe those things in your, you know, product. So only seeing the customer or need of the customer is not sufficient. You also have to see your competitor, what new they are doing, so that you, otherwise if he will introduce something new, he will have first mover advantage. So you need to see that what they are doing, and if they have introduced something, if they have, you know, launched a new technology, you have to, you know, deal with the market. You have to be on your, you know, you keep your guards on that all, I am going to implement it also. The next is own sales force. So of course, your own sales force, your personal executives, maybe your marketing persons, whosoever is there, you need to be in regular touch with them, because they know the market. They are dealing with people. They know the market very well. So they can always give you good suggestions that this is how you can improve the sales of your product. Of course, your own sales force is like, you know, distribution channel members, because they are also the one who are in direct contact with the customers. Then there is marketing research and advertising agencies. So here marketing research plays a very, very important role in your you know, product line, because these are the people who will continuously, you know, explore the market, and they will always tell you that this is how I can improve my service, this is how, you know, taking feedback from customers, not because they are in direct contact, but for example, they always, you know, ask, explore customers that what more can be done, how you want your product to be, how you are getting influenced with the current situation. Maybe a product was very good and satisfying the needs of the customers maybe 5 years ago, but today the customer is expecting you, you know, in the era of digitalization, or you know, people are more inclined towards luxury, you know, in their life, because everybody is, you know, so busy in this high-tech life that they want everything at their doorstep, you know. So maybe earlier they were okay with certain things, but today they may not be okay with, you know, the similar kind of service. फॉर एग्जाम्पल यू नो इट्स लाइक लाइक जोमैटो और स्विगी, अर्लियर पीपल वर ओके विद यू नो गोइंग एंड यू नो बाइंग सर्टन थिंग्स, और मे बी इफ एनी ऑफ द ब्रांच रेस्टोरेंट इज प्रोवाइडिंग दम होम डिलीवरी दे वर ओके, बट नाउ दे वॉन्ट एवरी थिंग एंड होम. सो यू नो दीज काइंड ऑफ इंटरमीडिएटरीज arise in the market who are providing you an extra service. So marketing research is something which will tell you how any area can be improved. And of course there is a role of advertising agencies also, because advertising agencies, they not only explore things but they also create things. You know, earlier maybe this thing was not at all required. Say for example, earlier nobody thought of, you know, having a air purifier at home, because everything was fine. But you know, because of more traffic and you know so much urbanization, people feel that there is so much pollution, so they think of, you know, having air purifiers at home. Earlier it was not required, right? But now it is very much required. So advertising agencies, basically not advertising or market research, not only you know find problem, explore problems, but they create such situations where investor or where customers, you know, intend to buy something. Then there are suppliers and vendors. Of course, those who are in direct contact with you, they may also suggest you. Supplier and vendors are just like distribution channels or own sales force type, who are in direct contact with the customers, or maybe they also know what is going on in the global market, right? So you know, maybe there were certain things initially which were not very popular in your country. For example, earlier in India, if we talk about you know, having this food chain culture was not very famous. If we talk about, you know, 20-25 years back, people used to eat from, you know, local vendors. But now people are so fond of these food chains. So you know, these food chains were in existence even before that, but in other countries, because you know, in India the education level or maybe you know income level was not that the people were very, you know, inclined towards such food chains. But now with the change of education, income and you know living standard, people have changed their living style, and they love to go, they love to explore such certain areas, right? Okay, so class, suppliers and vendors play this role that they may aware you about, you know, the global trends. So the next point here is company management. So how company management, see, in the management of the company, you may appoint people who have, you know, a lot of experience in the market, maybe, you know, 20-30 years of experience. And because of their own, you know, experience, they will know that, you know, this is how customer is going to react to a new thing. And this is how, you know, perception of people are changing. So they do a lot of, you know, brainstorming session where they will explore that this is how I can change the market trend. This is how we can, you know, probe a customer to react to a particular situation. So company management with, you know, a certain set of expertise can actually help you to generate ideas. Then the next one is scientists and consultants. Of course, if you are dealing in any technology specific area, there, you know, those research and development experts can help you to understand that how an idea can be generated, how things can be, you know, changed. For example, nowadays so many products are there which are particularly related to apps only, right? So for example, Ola, Uber, they don't have their own cars, they are just a medium to connect, you know, a vendor to a buyer. So, you know, there is Zomato, there is Swiggy, they are just intermediaries. So, you know, these app thing have, you know, come into picture from, you know, last decade, that people are using it again and again. So it has become such a thing nowadays that every time people are generating idea on the basis of technology, and they are just working as, you know, intermediary. They don't have anything of their own, right? So this is how you can change a system, this is how you can generate an idea, right? So here you can see feasibility study, a diagram. So here if you see, this is the process of feasibility study. So the first thing is generation of idea. So you know, you can generate ideas on the basis of you know, things which we have discussed just now. You can generate an idea, and the second step is initial screening. When you generate an idea, the first thing is initial screening. You will see, is the idea prima facie promising? So we'll see that after initial screening only, you will see that the idea is prima facie promising or not. For example, you know, if I give you an idea in a completely, you know, underdeveloped country where I'm launching an app, right, and where people are not that educated, internet speed is not there, basic infrastructure is not there, and I will tell you that, okay, I'll generate an app where this thing will happen. So, you know, this idea would not be a good idea in that area because people are not educated, living standard is so low that people will not follow it. So, you know, at first glance, you can reject this idea. So, at this stage, is the idea prima facie promising? We call it that, you know, at first glance, do you think that this idea is worthwhile or not? So if you feel the idea is not worthwhile, you will terminate it at this point only. But if you feel at first point it is looking, you know, a bit of promising, so you can plan feasibility study here. So this first stage is basically called preliminary work. In feasibility study, we do these 4 to 5 types of feasibility. So first is conduct market analysis, then there is technical analysis, there is financial analysis, then there is operational, legal, schedule, social and ecological, all those kind of, you know, studies. And after doing all these 4 or 5 types of analysis, you will see that is idea good, then prepare for funding proposal. If you find that idea is not good, then you will terminate it, right? So now we will understand in depth that, you know, these, how to do these 5 kinds of analysis. This we will discuss. Right. So first, let's understand the facets. We also call it facets of the project analysis. And here we'll see the first type of analysis is market analysis. So market analysis would answer you majorly 2 types of questions. What would be the aggregate demand of the product or service in the future? We'll see what is the aggregate demand. And second is what would be the market share of the project under appraisal. So 2 things we need to see, that what would be the demand of my product, and second thing I will see is what would be my market share. For example, there would be so many people, so many competitors you will have, what would be your share, what would be your market share, right? These 2 things I need to analyze. So to answer the above questions, the market analysis requires a wide variety of information and appropriate forecasting methods. So what will I do to answer these 2 questions? So what I will do, I will see consumption trends, like how people were consuming the product I want to launch, what were the past and present supply positions, what was the supply. See, if already there are so many suppliers of your product in the market, then what is the point, what new you are giving to the market? So this thing we have to see. Then production possibilities and constraints, how would you produce the product and what are the constraints, if the labor is available, raw material is available or not, so many things are there. Then imports and exports, for example, you know, if for your production you need to import certain thing, what is the import duty? If you want to export the product, with which country you are dealing with. For example, if you are dealing with Pakistan, India and Pakistan relations are always very constrained. So you have to see, is it feasible or not, you know? And structure of competition, are you dealing in perfect competition, oligopoly, monopoly? You have to see that. Then cost structure, what would be the cost structure? How much fixed cost is required? How much variable cost is required? Elasticity of demand is another very, very important thing, you know. Is if your, you know, product is very sensitive. For example, if you're dealing in gold people usually buy when there is any function, or maybe, you know, if there is marriage. So, you know, this kind of product has different kind of elasticity. Are you able to cope up with that kind of elasticity? Then consumer behavior, how, you know, consumer behavior, intention, motivation, attitude, preference and requirement. This is very important because, you know, consumer behavior is one thing which will change, you know, without even any, you know, prior knowledge. Suddenly people are not very fond of your product. So you have to understand what is the motivation, attitude of the people. Are people, you know, ready to spend this much? What are their requirements? Maybe in certain areas, people are more inclined towards luxury goods. And whenever any new kind of luxury comes into the market, they discard the previous one. And maybe there may be certain markets where people are okay with only normal goods. They are not inclined towards luxury goods. It depend on the, development of the country, developing country or developed country or underdeveloped country. So all these things you have to see. Then distribution channels and marketing policies, whether your product is going to have distribution channels or not. And here also, you will see that whether your product is, for example, cosmetics. I will give an example. There may be certain cosmetics whose outlets are not very easily available, but they intentionally do that to create, hype of the product in the market. So it depends. You want more distribution channels, you want less distribution channels. It completely depends. Then administrative, technical, and legal constraints are there. Yes, for example, you are dealing in a product where child labor is not allowed at all. Up to a certain age, people are not allowed. So you have to see all the labor laws, technicalities, all those things you have to see, right? So the second facet of feasibility study is technical analysis. So there are certain questions we need to ask ourselves when we are conducting a technical analysis. So the important questions are like, first is whether the preliminary test and studies have been done or provided for. So the first thing we require here is if we are trying to launch a new technology, so we have to see that whether preliminary tests are done or not. Because whenever you start a new technology direct, it is not good, it is not advisable to launch the, start the production immediately. Certain preliminary tests have to be conducted. The next is whether the availability of raw material, power, and other inputs has been established. So the second thing we need to see is whether, infrastructure is available or not for the implementation of the new technology, whether the raw material required is available or not, all the inputs required are there or not. Then whether the selected scale of operation is appropriate. So, the lot size of production has to be appropriate. It should not be overestimated or underestimated, because if it is overestimated, then there would be a problem of, breakdown of machinery. And if it is underestimated, it means you are not fully utilizing your resources. Then next is whether the production process chosen is suitable or not. Like whatever kind of process you have chosen, it should be, something which increase your efficiency and effectiveness. Less wastage should be there. Then next is whether the equipment and machine chosen are appropriate. Then whether the auxiliary equipment and supplements engineering work has been provided for or not. So you have to see that all the engineering work is properly done, supplements are there or not, all the equipment, auxiliary equipments are there or not. Then whether provisions have been made for the treatment of effluents. So how you are going to treat effluents, right? And then there is so next is whether the proposed layout of the site building and plan is sound. So the blueprints of the site where you are going to conduct production has to be approved by all the concerned authorities. For example, whatever permissions you have to take from municipal corporation, or maybe licensing you have to take, or sewage system, all the other things has to be cleared from the concerned authority. Then whether work schedules have been realistically drawn up. So this is very, very important that your work schedules have to be realistically drawn up. It should not be, something very vague. So everything, like optimistic time, pessimistic time, then most likely time, and worst case scenario, best case scenario, all these things have to be, done by proper caution, by understanding the market and understanding all the analysis, right? The next is whether the technology proposed to be employed is appropriate for the social point of view. So it is very important, to understand that whatever new technology you are going to launch, it should be as per the requirement of the people, right? Because whatever new technology you are using, it is for the betterment of the society. So, you have to see that the kind of technology you are using, whether this kind of technology is appropriate for the people. At times, if you use quite a high-tech technology, it may happen that the people are not able to adopt it. So your technology should be as per the requirement of the people, right? So the next facet of feasibility study is financial analysis. So what do we have to see in financial analysis? So here you can see that in financial analysis, the first and very important part of the study is the feasibility study is investment outlay. Okay. So investment outlay is how much investment is required, how much money has to be invested in the project, right? Then means of financing, how much, you know, from where you are going to obtain finances to start the project, because you are not going to invest all your money. You will take money from different sources, maybe bank loan, maybe, you know, IPOs, maybe, you know, venture funding or angel investors or maybe foreign investors. So where you are going, you have to create, you know, your own financial portfolio, where from different sources you have acquired money. Then cost of capital, how much returns you have to pay, right? So cost of capital is required. For example, what is the rate of interest you have to pay when you are taking a bank loan? What would be the return you have promised to your venture capitalist? So that is called cost of capital. So next is projected profitability. Projected profitability is, for example, how much return, ROI. They are basically talking about ROI. Then next is break-even point. Break-even point is the position where you have recovered all your investment. No profit, no loss. It means, for example, you have invested 1 crore in a project. So you have recovered 1 crore, and after this, whatever you will be earning, that would be your profit. The next is cash flows of the project. So, you know, break-even point is obviously very important, and cash flows are also very, very important. Why cash flows are so important? Because, you know, what would be your yearly inflow? For example, your break-even point will reach after 5 years, say, for example. And, you know, first 3 years, for example, there is no inflow at all. And after 3 years, at the end of 3 years, after that, you will be able to receive inflows. So are you okay with it or not? Because, you know, for 3 years, you have to work at your own. And this is a situation which is very uncertain. So it may happen that you know, your investors and your funders may feel quite anxious at this time. So what is the pattern of your cash flows? Investment worthwhileness judged in terms of various criteria of merit. So, you know, at you will see that whether your investment is worthwhile or not, because whatever your ROI is, or however your, you know, cash flows is, what is the break-even point. So, you know, all these things will be assessed to understand whether this project is worth, you know, putting your all your efforts and time or not. Then projected financial position is that what you will be earning out of it. That is very important. The level of risk involved. So obviously, in the above all the points, we have just talked about the input inflow and how we are getting return, how much you know return we are going to have, or what is the rate which we are giving to other party. Till now we have not talked about risk, but as I told you many a times that, you know, whenever we talk about return is only one side of a coin. The other side of the coin is always the risk. So if you only see return and not risk, then you will be in illusions. So you have to see that if I'm going to earn this much of return, for example, 30% return, so how much risk I have to take for this? Risk is basically the variability of return. So this is very, very important here, right? Okay. So the next type of analysis or the facet of feasibility study project management is economic analysis. So the major questions which are asked here are, the first is, and so, you know, first thing we have to understand here is the most important thing which we do in economic analysis, social cost benefit analysis. So social cost benefit analysis is about, you know, seeing all the cost involved in a project and seeing all the benefits we will receive after the project. So, and we'll compare whether the cost is higher or the benefit is higher. But when we talk about social cost benefit analysis, we will not only talk about, you know, only in quantitative terms. We also talk about qualitative terms, right? So let's understand this concept. So here, what are the direct economic benefits and cost of the project measured in terms of shadow prices and not in terms of market prices? So here, you know, this term which we are using here is shadow prices. राइट. ओके, सो व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट शैडो प्राइसेस आर द प्राइसेस विच आर बेसिकली नॉट द मार्केट, व्हेन देर इज नो यू नो मार्केट प्राइस इज देयर, राइट, एंड वी हैव टू प्रिडिक्ट यू नो द प्राइस ऑफ द गुड. सो बेसिकली शैडो प्राइस इज द रियल वर्थ ऑफ द इनपुट एंड आउटपुट. You know, market price can be overpriced or underpriced. They may not be at the actual price. But shadow price are basically the correct price of the good. For example, if I manufacture a pen, right? So the cost of pen for me was 5 rupees, say for example. And I am selling it, for example, at 2 rupee profit, so 7 rupees, right? So this can be called shadow price. But market price can be 15 rupees, 20 rupees, depending on the demand of the product. Right, because market prices are basically determined on the basis of demand and supply forces. But when we talk about shadow prices are basically the correct price, the efficient prices, which are not influenced by any external factor. So when we talk about economic analysis, we have to see that what is the benefit and cost of my project on the basis of shadow prices. It means original prices, not on the basis of market prices, because market prices are hampered by the market situation. Right, so whenever we do economic analysis, we only consider shadow prices here. We do not talk about the market prices, because market prices are maybe inflated or deflated according to the current market situation. So what would be the impact of the project on the distribution of income in the society? Because we are talking about economic analysis, we need to understand that if I'm starting a project, is it going to, you know, change the income level of the people in my society, in my country or not? So maybe, you know, if with my project more employment is generated or not, that is very, very important. Then what would be the impact of the project on the level of savings and investment in the society? You know, if obviously people will get employed, then their savings and investment will also change, because they will be able to save more, they would be able to, you know, invest more, and the level of income and expenditure will change. Yeah. Then what would be the contribution of the project towards the fulfillment of certain merit wants like self-sufficiency, employment and social order? So is my project is making a difference in the society? Are people are able to become independent, self-sufficient, level of you know, GDP is increasing or not, or maybe, you know, what we can say, the aggregate demand is increasing or not, employment is generated or not? So all these factors which are going to improve the economy, you know, what would be the impact of my project on the economy? That is my main concern in economic analysis, right? Here we have the next facet of feasibility study, that is ecological analysis. So when we talk about ecological analysis, the key questions raised in ecological analysis are, first, what is the likely damage caused by the project to the environment? So, you know, earlier it used to happen that the only criteria on the basis of which project was selected, used to be selected, was, you know, profitability. But, you know, as per changing times, when the society is growing and global warming is increasing, people are more aware about, you know, environmental damage. So nowadays, a project is not only selected on the basis of profitability, but the impact of the project on nature is also assessed, right? So here, as you can see, that they will see that whether this project is going to harm the environment or not. So obviously, you know, there are very less number of projects which are not going to harm the environment, because even if you start an IT project, it is going to affect the environment, right? So, you know, as there was a case like in certain country, I don't remember the name of the country, but where 5G was launched, within an hour, so many, 1 lakh, more than 1 lakh of sparrows were, you know, killed because of the new technology. So because one type of species will extinct from the environment, it is going to affect the ecological balance. So we have to see what is the impact of my project on the environment, right? So what is the cost of restoration? Or now I have to see whether this damage is restorable or not. At times the damage we are causing, it is not restorable. It is not going to get fine. So first I need to see whether the damage to my project is, you know, going to create is restorable or not. And if it is not, then obviously it is not worthwhile investment.
बट इफ इट इज़ रीस्टोरेबल आई विल आई कैन गो विद द प्रोजेक्ट. एंड पॉइंट इज वॉट इज द कॉस्ट ऑफ रीस्टोरेशन, दैट इज ऑल्सो वन इम्पॉर्टेंट फैक्टर. Is it restorable? Then what is the cost of restoration? And is it acceptable within the limits or not? You know, at times if the damage is within the acceptable limits, then we go with it. But we have to see. And for that, you know, there are certain guidelines in the in different, you know, government guidelines. So there are so many guidelines. So we have to see. Right. So here we have the key issues in project analysis. Let's understand these key issues. So in case of market analysis, the two most important aspects, you know, in previous slides we have studied that what are the key questions when you study these five facets of project analysis: market, technical, financial, economic and ecological. In market analysis there are two main issues which we need to answer here is, in nutshell, first is potential market and the second is market share. So when we do market analysis, all the other questions which we discuss in market analysis will be, you know, summed down to two factors, that what is the potential market for my product, right? And second is, out of that whole market, what would be my share, okay? Then second is technical analysis. In technical analysis, we'll see there are two issues: technical viability and sensible choices. Technical viability basically tells that if I'm going to launch this new technology, is it going to, you know, viable in the environment where I am launching this technology. For example, you are launching a high-tech technology in a country where people are not that educated. So it is not viable. People will not be able to understand because their, you know, education level or their living standard is not as per the requirement, you know, or maybe the infrastructure is also not there, right? Because when you launch a technology, certain kind of, you know, internet speed and basic infrastructure has to be there. So you will see whether your technology is viable in a particular country or not. Then sensible choices basically, are you going to make the technology or are you going to buy the technology? So at times you develop the technology, but at times what will happen, you are not in a position to make a technology because of lack of, you know, know-how or maybe, you know, funds. So in that case, maybe it is better to buy it directly and have training sessions. So it depends from project to project, whether you are going to make it or buy it, make or buy. Then next is financial analysis. Obviously, in financial analysis, there are risk and return. How much return you are going to take and what is the risk involved. Then next is economic analysis. Economic analysis, what we do in economic analysis, benefits and cost and shadow prices. Social cost benefit analysis we do here. What is the cost of the project and what is the benefit of the project in shadow prices. And when we talk about shadow prices are basically the prices which are not actually the market prices. These are the true value of your product, right? And other impact is impact on the, income, impact on the employment, impact on the living standard of the people. So all those things we'll see in economic analysis. Then ecological, how much damage your project is doing to the environment. And is it restorable or not? Whether, you know, if you are creating too much of air pollution, is it restorable? How much time would be needed? And for example, land pollution, water pollution, whatever kind of pollution your project is going to make, it is restorable. How much time it is going to take? What would the cost? So all these things we have to see.
So till now we have discussed all the ifs and buts of feasibility study and what, you know, 4 to 5 kinds of analysis which we have to do to approve a project, right? So now in today's class we will be discussing feasibility with the help of an example, right? So today I will be taking an example of a civil project, that is Delhi Metro, Right. So, you know, let's start with the first step of feasibility study, that is generation of ideas. So, you know, first thing we need to understand here is how the idea of, you know, having a mode of transportation arise, and why the need of such a mode of transformation was a mode of transportation was needed in a city like Delhi. You know, this project altogether started in late 90s when Delhi government thought of having a mode of transportation which should be, you know, easy and which should be more affordable and having a, you know, world-class transportation system. So why this idea came into the minds of the, you know, government? So, you know, that time the roads of Delhi were not very good, and the major problem which was being faced by the people was traffic, you know. And at that time there were only blue line buses, and people used to travel by their own transportation systems. But other than own transportation system, people at that time, you know, own mode of transportation was also very less that time. But maximum people used to travel by blue line buses, and blue line buses or DTC buses. Yeah, but those buses were very crowded, overcrowded, and you know, many accidents used to happen because of blue line buses, because they were overcrowded. You know, so many accidents used to happen because of blue line buses and mode of transportation. There was over traffic on the roads. People were suffering problems because of not a good mode of transportation. So at that time, government thought of launching a mode of transportation which should be accessible by a very common man also, plus by any middle class person, and for, you know, long distances also. So that time they thought of introducing Delhi Metro. And how this idea came into, you know, existence, because similar type of mode of transportation was developed in other countries, and one of the country was Japan that time. Right. So, you know what, whenever you start an idea, first thing you see that is there a problem in the existing system? Yes, there was a problem in the existing system because people were facing problem while, you know, commuting from one place to another. So when they thought of launching Delhi Metro, they compared the market situation, level of, you know, urbanization, everything with the similar type of country. Like they compared it with other countries where such a mode of transportation was developed already. And they analyzed whether, you know, if we launch a transportation system like Metro, will it be successful or not? So, you know, after doing a thorough analysis, they thought that yes, this mode of transportation can be successful in Delhi because the level of urbanization, education level, and income level, everything, you know, was changing gradually. So this is how this idea was generated. So first step is generation of idea. So initial screening they did, obviously, as I told you, that they saw that, you know, similar type of projects were successful in other countries or not. So yes, in other countries when a similar kind of project was launched, it was very successful. So they thought that yes, this idea can be good in Delhi also. So this idea was prima facie promising. So then they start for feasibility study. Now first is conduct market analysis. So let us understand how did they do market analysis. You know, for market analysis, as I told you, there were two very important things. That first was what is market share and what is your share. What is market aggregate demand of the product? And what is your share in the market? So what they thought is, yes, of course, the market share is huge. Market area is huge because everybody used to, you know, commute from one place to another. Everybody have to go from, you know, from their house to offices, from, you know, one place to another. So of course, the market was very huge. Now, second thing was that whether, what is your share in all this? Now the major competition of the Delhi government at that time was blue line buses, because you know every person at that time used to travel by blue line buses. So the major competition of Delhi government at that time was blue line buses. So the first thing you know what they did was many of the blue line buses were banned. I mean they were banned on the basis of year of service. So probably if the year of service of a particular bus has crossed, for example, 10 years, that bus would has to be, you know, banned. So similarly, many routes were banned. First thing they did this, right? So this is how they increase their market share. But of course, in case of a civil project, especially a government project, they could have done this. But maybe in other projects, it is not possible. So you have to identify what is the aggregate demand of the product and what is your share market share. Right? So this is how they have done market analysis of Delhi Metro. Then second is technical analysis. In technical analysis, they basically saw that whether this product is going to have, you know, feasibility, technical visibility in India or not. Because at that time, the level of, you know, technical know-how was not very sound in India. So, you know, this technical know-how process and financial analysis process is quite interrelated here. So let us understand how these two parts were very, very interrelated. So, you know, for technical know-how, technical analysis, first they have to develop. Let's discuss that first they have to develop a network of metro line. So for that, what they did was they removed all the illegal constructions. And they removed all the illegal construction for some areas. If there was something legal also, they have to remove it because they had to develop a metro line. So, and second thing they do is they did was they removed all the factories and commercial things out of Delhi. They removed everything from Delhi. So I before you know metro, all the commercial activities used to happen in Delhi only, like factory setups. But you know when they wanted to launch Delhi Metro, they removed all the commercial activities, factories on the outskirts. So they developed outskirts, you know. So this is how they also created demand of metro, because if everything is so far away, all the commercial areas are quite far away, then obviously people had to travel. So then Delhi Metro would be required. So what all they did was, first they removed all the illegal constructions on the roads. Second, whatever, even if they are legal, they removed them from main area and they, you know, gave them other spaces at the outskirts. Right, then they developed metro line there. And to develop metro line, what they had to do was, first is you know, knowing technical know-how was very, very important that time. So here they had a deal with a Japanese company. So here comes the financial analysis part, that how they were going to, you know, make a technology. So this part which I'm discussing here, we are covering both technical and financial, right? So, you know, develop Delhi Metro, they had a contract with a Japanese company, that the Japanese company will prepare all the engines, all the Delhi metros, and they, you know, help even Indian engineers to understand the technology. And, you know, everything would be done. In fact, many engineers from Delhi would be sent to Japan to understand the technology, because initially none of the Indian engineers or you know anybody in technical area knew how to develop this technology. So everything, the whole contract was given to a Japanese company. And for that, you know, for funding, they didn't pay immediately. They said that once the project would be completed, the Japanese company will share profits. So they didn't pay a penny, but they shared profit. They had a contract to share profits in the future. So this is how they arranged their funds. They didn't invest, but they didn't invest in technology. So the, you know, if you see here, they cover two aspects. First is technical know-how. They didn't produce it because they didn't have the, you know, technical know-how with them. So, you know, there are two decisions in technical analysis, whether to buy it or to make it. So they didn't make it because they didn't have technical know-how, say, so they decided to buy it. So here one, this question is solved in technical analysis. And in financial analysis, how to procure funds, they didn't invest, but they had a contract with the Japanese company that Japanese companies is going to share profits with of Delhi Metro once it would be at the, you know, running stage. So this is how they learned. And another source of, you know, income for them was when they were creating metro stations, there were so many shops created. So they sold these shops and they created so many malls there. So this is how they earned income, by selling shops at the metro station, or by allowing brands to have their outlets by creating malls in near to metro stations. They earned, right? So in fact, they were earning a lot. If you notice, this is how they earned a lot. So, you know, simultaneously when they were creating metro, they were creating metro lines, they were having their metro lines, they were earning also from different modes, right? So they have a constant financial inflow. So their technical problem and their financial problems were solved, right? So this is how they have solved their problem of technicalities and their financial analysis. And they were also generating revenue even before the construction of the whole metro, or maybe, you know, even before the metro was in use. So this is done. Then next is economic analysis. In economic analysis, the major aspect was what is the impact of your project on the, you know, on the economy. So, you know, major thing is, what is the impact on the living standard of the people? What is the impact on, you know, the on the earning of the people, income, living standard, employment? So, you know, this project actually increased the living standard of people. Earlier, people used to travel from, you know, buses or maybe, you know, other modes of transportation. So it actually enhanced the living standard of the people. Then of course there was employment, because employment was generated by metro in each sphere of life, you know, from laborers to, you know, engineers to CA to everybody, you know, employment was generated in each and every sphere of life. In fact, you know, from technicalities to accounting to, you know, admin, in each and every area employment was generated. And when employment was generated, obviously if there is more employment, it means there is better income, right? So income level has increased because of this project, and people were generating more income, and the living standard has improved. So, you know, we can say that because of launch of this project, the overall economic impact was very fruitful, right? So economic impact was good. Then there was ecological impact. So ecological impact, we see that what kind of, you know, pollution the project is creating, and how the project is, you know, hampering the environment. So here, if you see that, yes, the project was very environmental friendly, because, you know, once the project was complete, of course, at the phase of construction, there was pollution, but this is, you know, restorable. But otherwise, the project is quite environment friendly. There is no pollution. In fact, when there were buses, there was pollution. But because of this project, there is no pollution, right? So this is how this project is also very much environment friendly, right? So if you see this project, there is, everything is so planned. If you see market analysis, if you see technical analysis, if you see financial analysis and ecological and economic analysis. So in all the spheres, in all these, you know, five kinds of analysis, the project seems to be a very good and prosperous project. So after evaluating the project on the basis of these five, you know, criterias, project was found to be very, very good, and they go for funding proposal. And you know, funding they have also done very nicely, right? So this is how we develop a project through feasibility study, right?